Hey guys, it's a beautiful day at McKinney Falls. We're just south of Austin, Texas. I used to live here and it's a wonderful place to get out. We brought the Rad Power Bikes RadMini. This is the high step version. They do have a step through, which you see over here in white. Really awesome bikes. Those smaller tires lower the whole frame. Okay, so it makes it approachable, very stable. These are fat tires as well. Kind of custom tread, checkerboard pattern, so it can really ride on or off-road very capably. I love that they've got a suspension fork as well, and it's not just a, you know, kind of a basic, yeah, suspension. This one actually has compression to lock out, so you can fully lock this out if you're someone who's actually not riding off-road and you don't want that, like, bouncy feeling. The tires already give you a lot of comfort just because of the higher air volume. And then they have preload adjust, so you can preload that spring if you are a heavier rider and you don't want to use some of that spring just based on your body weight. So I love that fork. It is custom, 135 millimeter hub spacing up front, 175 in the rear. Fat bike specific Bafang planetary geared hub motor, 750 watts, 80 newton meters of torque. And this is really powerful motor when you couple it with a smaller diameter wheel, because you get an increased mechanical advantage compared to like the full size Rad Rovers. See, that's what we got over here. We got the black one, high step. It doesn't fold, so it's not going to be as easy to take along if you're going on an RV trip. It's got a higher standover height, but you know, This is really comparable, similar kind of a performance and feel, though I must say it's a little bit less comfortable sometimes, let's say, because, you know, this higher attack angle, because the smaller wheel, it runs into things and it kind of falls into divots a little bit easier. So that's one of the trade-offs. Love that this thing comes with the wide plastic fenders to help keep you clean and dry. See, the front one actually extends pretty low there, and I appreciate that. Same with the rear. You know, that's really nice. They got these awesome racks with little bungee loop right here, Yep compatible window. They've got baskets and trays and panniers that hang off from the side. There's even like an insulated bag. Really wonderful. I mean, Rad Power Bikes has done a great job refining these bikes over the years, and there's a lot of attention to detail that really impresses me, like these integrated lights. They run off the main battery pack, which is pretty high capacity, 48 volts, 14 amp hours, 672 watt hours. I would call, you know, 500 watt hours pretty standard, pretty good. So 672, that's awesome. Weighs 7.2 pounds, and it is compatible, cross-compatible with the other bikes. So you could get a pair of these bikes, maybe a step through and a high step. Maybe you've got the Rad Rover. It's really nice to have a battery system that's like interchangeable. It makes it easier to replace. So, you know, we got a little 4 LED charge level indicator right there. It's nice, kind of, you know, semi-aerodynamic shape. It slides on like this. It mounts and then slides down. And depending on which frame we're talking about, like if it's the Rad Minis, you might have to raise the seat and turn it or take it off. So getting the battery on and off on some models is a little easier, like the Rad Rover. On others, it takes a little bit more time. Here's the charging port on the right hand side. It's got a little rubber cover that's fairly easy to use. Sometimes those aren't so easy to use on other bikes. They don't seat very well. Oh yeah, you know, 48 volt, 14 amp hour, 672 watt hours. These weigh about, you know, 7.6, 7.7 pounds. They do have two fuses right there, which is nice. I don't have an IP rating, ingress protection rating, but they say they're highly water resistant, just like the motor and the display. So they say you can ride these bikes around in rain and in wet conditions. You're definitely not supposed to submerge them or anything, but it's nice that they warranty them for that 1 year comprehensive, and that the battery pack replacements are a little more affordable because the controller unit is separate. And then another unique quality about these batteries is that the locking mechanism has three different slots. So right now you could slide it onto the bike because that pin is not protruding, and then once it's on, you could kind of push and turn and it'll lock to the frame, and you can remove the key, and in this mode, it's off, so no one can tamper with your display, which is kind of cool. No one's gonna be able to use the throttle or anything, and then you take it to that next step, right, still locked, and now take the key out, the bike will work. So it's really cool for people who don't wanna take this off their bike but don't want people tampering. You kind of lock it and turn the bike off. I think that's really nice, and there are a lot of other bikes that don't do that, so good job, Rad.
And I wanted to highlight that the bikes do come with a little tool pouch, a bunch of kind of basic tools, and then this is what the charger looks like. It's just a 2-amp charger, so, you know, it's going to take 6 hours if your battery's all the way empty, but it only weighs 1.5 pounds, which is nice. These guys have a pretty good 1-year comprehensive warranty, and then they also deliver bikes in some locations. They're kind of doing this Rad mobile service thing where they'll assemble the bike and set it up. It's a neat company. They've been around for quite a while, and I've been reviewing now and seeing how they improve upon the new models each year. But they preserve the look, the feel, sort of the simplicity of these, because they are trying to keep that relatively affordable price point, $1,499. That's a lot less than a lot of the competing bikes. Now, there are some bikes out there now that are even a little bit lower, but they don't have like the reputation and the high quality support that Rad does. So that's one of the reasons I'm usually giving them a thumbs up and ranking them pretty well back at the website. So here's the headlight. It's also integrated, and they've got this new kind of bladed aluminum alloy heatsink thing going on. I really appreciate that. And there's this ring, and we'll get to that a little bit later. I want to show it off. But you'll notice that there's just tons of cables up here. So it's like, what's going on? Well, they've got these mechanical disc brakes, and each lever has a motor inhibitor. So it's like a little switch that tells the motor to stop anytime you pull the brakes. So it's a kind of a safety feature. They've got this little bell. There's no wire for that, thankfully. Then there's a button pad, the display panel, and a shifter. So let's go through some of that equipment back here. We've got a Shimano Altus derailleur, which is like one step up from the entry point on the Shimano group set. So that's nice. At least they didn't go completely low end. And then we've got a 14 to 34 tooth DNP nickel coated freewheel. So we've got that really large 34 tooth cog, and that's going to make it easier to start and climb, which is really nice. I mean, again, you've got this really powerful motor with a throttle, so these are very capable bikes, but it's great that they went above and beyond and kind of stepped it up. It's going to shift a lot smoother. It's not going to rust as easily. Got a nice slap guard here to keep your frame looking black, because it would chip up and you'd see silver underneath if you didn't have that. I love that they've got a derailleur guard right here, so if the bike tips, or if you're folding this and packing it up in like an RV or something like that, it's nice to protect the sensitive bits, and the derailleur is definitely one of the more sensitive pieces. Up here, we've got an aluminum alloy chain guide, and see, that actually helps to prevent the chain from bouncing off if you're on bumpy terrain like we are today. It also protects your clothing. So I've been riding around all day on these bikes, and my pants are looking pretty clean still, which is nice. It's almost like a chain cover, but without the extra plastic and stuff to bounce around. So I appreciate that. It doubles as kind of a bash guard down here and protects the controller. That's one of the things that's a little bit unsightly about these bikes. They have the external controller, fully potted, a little bit higher amperage on that. So it's able to support that high powered motor and handle the 48 volt system. So that's, you know, I guess it's a little bit more modular too if it gets damaged. You'll see that these are not internally routed cables. That means they won't get pinched quite as easily. 12 magnet cadence sensor down here. And in my experience, it's actually very quick to start and stop. It's higher resolution. I do appreciate that. There are newer cadence sensors that are kind of mounted on that other side that are sealed. This one, it could get dirty and it's a little bit more exposed, but again, it performs really well. So I can see why they've stuck with that. And then there's this support arm down here. So when you fold the bike, again, it just keeps everything well protected. They really upgraded the pedals here. I think they've had these for a while, so I shouldn't say they've upgraded it, but compared to other companies that use plastic pedals, these are aluminum alloy, and see, they're fairly large. They're not quite as large as a non-folding Welgo platform pedal, which you can see over here on the Rad Rover. These are my favorites right here. Really nice pedals, but again, they don't fold, and so that's one of the features that you get with these bikes. Toss it into your RV or maybe in a closet if you just don't have that much space. It only comes in one frame size, but it does offer this telescoping stem, so you can raise it up a little bit. We've got this mid-rise handlebar, and then a very short stem. I guess that's a top point. Maybe this is like a steering tube. To me, this whole thing is kind of a stem, but it's fairly adjustable, and then it's not as long, so you're not going to have to reach forward, kind of crane your neck over and get your back and neck sensitive. I like that they've really thought about ergonomics on these bikes. They're more like a kind of a have fun neighborhood, maybe occasionally romp around in a little bit of snow or sand. They are capable. I've taken these things to Mexico and actually tried them on a soft sandy beach, and it works surprisingly well, especially if you lower the tire pressure. So the range is like, you know, 5 to 20 PSI. I'll have more information on that back at the website, but look at this, they're co-branded. So it says Rad Power Bikes by Kenda, K-Rad. 30 TPI casing, it's got puncture resistant tire casing, so very nice considering yeah, the front wheel has quick release, but in the rear, you've got the derailleur and the power cable. You really don't want to get a flat. It's a little bit of work if that does happen. So nice to see that they've got the puncture resistant. And then also that reflective stripe, it pairs really nicely with the lights. And for a black bike like this, where all the cables blend in, the saddle, everything looks really nice, even the spokes, 12-gauge spokes. But they're black. They don't reflect very, very much light. And, you know, you are a little bit lower on these folding bikes, so I like that there's a real emphasis on safety here. Good kickstand positioning. You're not going to get, like, heel strikes as you pedal. It's also going to support panniers or a loaded rack if you load that thing up. It's something I think about for people who might want to commute with a platform like this. I see these all over the place. You know, it's a pretty popular brand. And again, the plastic fenders, not going to get scratched up and rust. They're not going to add as much weight as aluminum alloy. Maybe not going to be as noisy. They might rattle a little bit, but not much. I mean, they're pretty impressive. This bike weighs 68.3 pounds, so it is not super lightweight. The Rad Rovers, like the full-size bikes, they're like 71.5 pounds. So it's kind of comparable. Even though it looks smaller, you're still getting basically the same drive systems, and they reinforce the frame with like these gussets and extra tubing here to be very stiff and sturdy so it can handle heavier riders and just not wear out, not break on you. I mentioned the suspension fork and the tires before, but one of the accessories they sell is a 27.2 millimeter Suntour NCX suspension seat post, so you could turn this into kind of a full suspension, cushy ride, and that is adjustable. It has springs, so you can tighten those up. Something I think about, again, especially with the smaller tires, and the faster you ride, the further you ride, the more comfort you wanna get, because otherwise it's no fun. So we've got these stitched, ergonomic, faux leather grips. They can twist a little bit. They're not locking, but it's kind of a minor complaint. They match. They've done a really good job. You get brown over there if you go for the step through. And then the bell and everything, pretty nice. The brakes, that's another area where there's a little bit of a compromise to keep that price point low. So we've got four-finger levers with the rubberized edge. They're comfortable, but they have four-finger levers because you need to pull a little bit harder. These are mechanical brakes. They have extra large rotors, 180 millimeters in the front and the rear, which is great. You really don't see much beyond that. A lot of like downhill bikes will have 200 millimeter rotors, but for such a small wheel size, this is almost like overkill, and it means that you're gonna get good cooling and a good mechanical advantage for stopping. So I really appreciate that. The right lever is gonna require the most hand effort because it goes all the way back here. It's a longer housing, there's more friction. So it would be cool to see hydraulic disc brakes someday from these guys, but this totally gets the job done, and it's a little easier to adjust aftermarket. So kind of keep that in mind. I also like that they've got these extra big levers for opening and closing the seat binder right there. So you'll see that they've kind of angled it up so it doesn't interact with the battery and it's kind of got to tilt up a little bit, but it's easier to adjust. Same thing over here for the clasps that allow you to unfold the bike. So I'm gonna hand you guys off to Eric here so he can film me do a quick little folding demonstration. Thanks, Eric.
Yep.
Okay, so a lot of times the first thing I'll do is fold the pedals in like this. There we go. Got this locking pin up here so it won't come undone. Got that sliding stem, gotta love that. And then the main folding joint, which is actually fairly narrow. I appreciate that because some of the other bikes that have an integrated battery, it's really wide and you can hit your knee or your calves. And my girlfriend did that once. She was not happy. So I like that this is narrower. You kind of pull it over like this and then you pull up and it unlocks, and then it allows you to start folding the bike. So a lot of times I'll kind of fold this down, bring it like this, and then carefully here, want to scratch the frame, bring it back. There we go. So let me see this real quick, Eric. So depending on how you fold it, the handlebar will either be out, or you can spin it and put the handlebar in between. It's really up to you, but I recommend bringing a towel and maybe like a bungee cord or something just to keep it folded. They don't have a magnetic clasp here. There's no rubber band situation, which you do see on some of the other folding bikes, but again, there's nothing that's going to rattle around a whole lot. I'm just thinking about trying to keep the frame in good shape. And again, if this tumbles onto its side, like maybe it's in the back of an RV, you've got that derailleur guard, which is really important so that the sensitive bits, which are on the outside of the bike, aren't going to get damaged as easily. Same thing with the display right here. So it's kind of pointed down. You can swivel it even further just so it doesn't make contact with anything. Here you go, Eric. I want to kind of mess with this for a second again. If we, let's see, turn it up like this. If I actually spin it like this, there we go. And that was the other way. The handlebar is now inside the frame, right? So again, there's a little bit of weight that you're having to deal with on a folding fat tire bike like this. You can take the battery off, 7.7 pounds for that. The motor itself weighs about 8.7 pounds. So there's really no getting around it. You take the saddle off, the seat tube, get some help with this, get a friend if you're lifting it into the back of a car or something. But otherwise, they fold pretty well and they stay in the unfolded position, that they aren't like rattling loose while you're riding or anything, which is important. So one of the other little complaints I have about the high step RadMini is that, you know, it doesn't have bottle cage bosses. They just, I guess they didn't know where to fit them on. You can see that the Step-Thru Rad Rover has them on the top tube. The full size Rad Rover, they put the battery forward a little bit lower, more aggressive position. They got bottle cage bosses underneath, but it wouldn't fit. Over here on the RadMini Step-Thru, you can see that they've got them on the top tube, but again, they just didn't, I guess they didn't have room on that one. That's the one thing, that's the one reason for me personally where I was like, well, maybe I'd go for that Step-Thru, but I think it only comes in white. And this is a fourth generation build of the RadMini. You can see the little four down there. So it's kind of neat. Their bikes are, they've been around for a while. We're on to the fifth generation for the high step Rad Rover. They've really dialed this thing in. And I think that's kind of neat. It really speaks to just how well this company's done and how much time they've had to dial things in. And they've used that time well. Okay, so to boot this thing up, you press the mode button here. 2.75 inch display. It's grayscale LCD. Got 5 ticks for the battery charge level, which it'd be nice if there were 10, you know, or maybe a percentage readout, but it's kind of good enough. And then odometer over here, if you press the mode button again, it switches to trip distance, which is nice. Current speed, if you hold the up arrow, it goes to average speed and maximum speed. So it's kind of a nice little trick. Down here, pedal assist one, it always starts in pedal assist one, which is actually really smooth and comfortable. Some of the older bikes, it was like full power and it was like, oh man, you know, why do we even have 5 levels if they're all kind of zippy? This is a lot more natural. It's a smoother power curve. And you can take it down to zero and just use it like a scooter. You got the throttle. The throttle overrides all of the assist levels and gives you full power. And that's nice because this is a variable speed twist throttle. So I like that. A lot of times I'll be riding in level 2 or 3 and then I'll just use the throttle to zip up to speed to catch up to a friend. And then we've got a watt meter over here. If we hold the up and mode button, we get the lights. I'll show you those in a little bit. And if we hold the down arrow, as long as it's in one of the 5 levels of assist, we get walk mode, which is really handy if you find yourself in a precarious situation, or maybe it's just not appropriate to ride the bike, but you don't want to push the 68 pounds around. That walk mode is pretty handy. There's also some settings in here. So if you hold the up and down arrows simultaneously, you can select the wheel size. Press the mode button. Now we can select the top speed, and you can actually lower it down to 12 kilometers per hour, which is nice for someone who just doesn't feel comfortable at high speeds. And then the next one, we can change the backlight display brightness. So I'm taking it all the way up so we can see that later. Miles per hour, kilometers per hour. Now we've gone all the way through. So I'm going to hold the mode button again and do a little ride test with you. So here we go. I'm in the lowest level of assist. Really comfortable and subtle. I appreciate that a lot. Now we're climbing, so I'm gonna take it up to level 3. It's my favorite. Beautiful, beautiful. Climbs pretty well. Very fast cadence sensor. Do some twist throttle action. Definitely a zippier sounding motor, but it's also one of the more powerful ones.
That's the case with most of the Bafang motors that I test. And they did kind of custom configure it with Rad Power Bikes, just like the tires and the display. Everything on these bikes is sort of co-branded, including the lights. It's a pretty cool setup that way. I'm gonna shift the gears now. Actually, I might take it down to level 3 again, go through some gears. Shifting really nicely. You know, you do have the big thumb shifter and I have to reach a little bit, which I kind of prefer the tiny triggers, but these work well with gloves and they provide a little extra room for that twist throttle housing. So I kind of understand why they did that. Now that we're in the shade, should be able to see that display backlighting a little bit better. For me, it's pretty obvious. So the kickstand. Now I can show you that headlight. So check it out. There's like an LED light ring and they've cut out the sides so you can see it from the sides along with those reflective sidewalls. And then the main light, it's definitely bright. It's a lot more focused, so you can aim this down. It does point where you steer unless you get the rack, and the rack connects right here to these bolts. It's very solid. It connects to the frame, so it's not going to dump as you turn the bike. It's not going to spill or impact your steering, but it would kind of block the light. So they have another mount, and you mount the light out here below the rack. And when you do that, it no longer points where you steer. So it's a bit of a trade-off. At the end of the day though, you know, you're still getting a light, which is nice, and it's still running off that main battery pack. So I appreciate that. And then the rear light is also phenomenal. It's one LED with these light pipes. I know it looks like it's flashing on screen, but that's just because of the frames per second conflict going on. This is the flashing mode that's designed for the bike, and that's very unique. Not a lot of e-bikes have integrated lights or even flashing lights at all. This is one of the only ones that I know of. So I'm gonna go back to solid. Again, I know it doesn't look solid to you guys. Let's do those brake levers again. Look at that, bright mode. So that is just really cool. It's like the only light that has flashing, that has the integration, and that's important. You know, again, you're low to the ground. You wanna be seen. Gives you some side visibility and it gives people an extra like, hey, I'm here, I'm stopping. Wonderful to see. And again, at $14.99, I want to call out the plush saddle here with the handle. There's a lot of little refinements, the stem, the mid-rise bar. That's all stuff that makes this bike more enjoyable, in addition to like the service that they offer and the warranty and stuff. So I'm gonna hop on this and head back. Okay guys, from here you can see that 48 tooth chainring. I love that it has the guide, both to keep it on when you're folding it, but also so it doesn't bounce off when you're on rough, rocky terrain. And then 11 to 34 teeth in the rear. I thought it was 14 to 34. I mean, that's awesome. You have a smaller cog for high speeds, and then that 34 tooth for climbing and getting started. It's a really nice setup. I'm just gonna pedal along. I like to start in kind of, I'm gonna do level 2. It's still really subtle and smooth. It's a little bit quieter, and then I can override with the throttle. It's really nice. Sometimes those lower assist levels just, they come on too strong. And it's not as smooth as this, so I'm a fan. And just having the throttle, being able to override like that at full power in all levels is a big deal to me. This time I'm gonna start off in level 5. You can see how quickly it starts and stops, and also get an idea of how much noise it can produce at full power. Very nice. Well, guys, I think that's about it. that is the new RadMini. It's the high step version, pretty cool looking bike. I'm really impressed with it, all the little refinements and stuff, especially the lights and the safety. That's a big deal for me. I've measured all the specs, put them back at the website, ElectricBikeReview.com, and I've got a cool comparison tool, so you can compare this to the Step-Thru, to the Rad Rover, anything you want. Of course, sound off if you have feedback about this or if you have other requests. Do my best to cover this stuff and really be thorough for y'all. I hope you have a great day. I love you. Ride safe. We'll see you on the next one.